Today our pirate prentice rises from indenture freed. Strong his arm and keen his scent is, he's a pirate now indeed.
Here's good luck to Frederick's ventures, Frederick's out of his indenture.
2 and 20 now he's rising, and alone he's fit to fly, which we're bent on signalizing with unusual revelry.
Here's good luck to Frederick's ventures, Frederick's out of his indenture. Or aboard the pirate sherry as we sail this mountain day. When we took it down the dead and quickly made it up again.
Oh, for a would ascend the brightest heaven of invention. A kingdom for a stage, princes to act, and monarchs to behold a swelling scene. Then should the warlike Harry...
No!
Wrong play!
Oh. Well, Frederick, from today, you rank as a full-blown member of our band!
My friends, I thank you all from my heart for your kindly wishes. Would that I could repay them as they deserve.
What do you mean?
Well, today I am out of my indentures, and today I leave you forever.
Why, Frederick, this is quite unaccountable. A keener hand at scuttling a Cunarder, or cutting out a White Star, never shift a hand's fight.
Yes, I have done my best for you, and why? Because it was my duty under my indentures, and I am the slave of duty. As a child, when I was apprenticed to your band, it was through an error. No matter. The mistake was ours, not yours, and I was honor-bound by it.
An error? What error?
I cannot tell you. It would reflect upon my well-loved roof.
Nay, dear master, for years my mind has been gnawed by the cankering tooth of mystery. Better have it out at once. When Frederick was a little lad, he proved so brave and daring. His father thought he'd apprentice him to some career seafaring. I was, alas, his nursery maid, so it fell to my lot to take and bind the promising boy apprentice to a pilot. A life not bad for a hardy lad, though surely not a pilot. Though I'm a nurse, you might do worse than make your boy a pilot. I was a stupid nursery maid, on breakers always steering, and I did not catch the word aright through being hard of hearing, mistaking my instructions, which within my brain did gyrate. I took and bound this promising boy apprentice to a pirate. A sad mistake it was to make, and doom him to a vile lot. I bound him to a pirate view instead of to a pilot. I soon found out beyond all doubt the scope of this disaster, but I had the face to return to my place and break it to my master. A nursery maid is not afraid of what you people call work, so I made up my mind to go as a kind of practical maid of all work. And that is how you find me now, a member of your Shylock, which you wouldn't have found had he been bound apprentice to a pilot. Pardon, Frederick, pardon.
Rise, sweet one, rise. I have long pardoned you.
The two words were so very much alike. Yeah,
they were. They still are, though years have rolled over the hedge. But this afternoon, my obligation ceases. Fellow pirates, individually, I love you all with affection unspeakable. But collectively, I look upon you with a disgust that amounts to absolute detestation. Oh, pity me, my beloved friends, for such is my sense of duty that once out of my indentures, I shall feel bound to devote myself heart and soul to your extermination.
Well, Frederick, if you conscientiously...
Conscientiously!
If you conscientiously feel that it is your duty to destroy us, we cannot blame you for acting on that conviction. Always act in accordance with the dictates of your conscience, my boy, and chance the consequences.
Besides, we can offer you little temptation to remain with us. We don't seem to be able to make piracy pay. I'm not sure why, but we don't.
I know why.
Why?
Well, I cannot tell you.
Why not, my boy?
It wouldn't be right.
Well, it's only 11:30. You're one of us till the clock strikes 12.
True! And until then, you are bound to protect our interests.
It is my duty to tell you that you are too tender-hearted. instance, you make a point of never attacking a weaker party than yourselves, and when you attack a stronger party, you invariably get thrashed.
Yes! There is some truth in that.
Yes. Then again, you make a point of never molesting an orphan.
Of course! We are orphans ourselves!
And we know what it is.
Yes. But it has got about. Now everybody knows, and what is the consequence? Everyone we capture says he's an orphan. Why, the last three ships we took were manned entirely by orphans. We had to let them go. One would think that Great Britain's mercantile navy was recruited solely from her orphan asylums. Yes, which we know is not the case.
Ah, but hang it all! You wouldn't have us absolutely merciless!
Ah, there's my difficulty. Before 12 I would, after 12 I wouldn't. Was ever a man placed in so delicate a position?
And Ruth, your own Ruth, whom you love so well, and who's won her middle-aged way into your boyish heart, what is to become of her?
Oh, he'll take you with him.
Oh, well, Ruth, I find some little difficulty about you. It is true, I admire you very much, but I have been constantly at sea since I was 8 years old, and yours is the only woman's face that I have seen during that time. I think it is a sweet face.
Oh, it is.
I say I think it is. That is my impression. But since I have not had the opportunity of comparing you with other women, well, I just may be mistaken.
True.
What a terrible thing it would be if I were to marry this innocent person and find out that she is, on the whole, plain.
Oh, Ruth is very... well, is very well, indeed.
Yes, where are the remains of a fine woman about you?
You really think so?
Oh, yes, I do.
Well, then I will not be so selfish as to take her from you. So, in justice to her and in consideration for you, I will leave her behind.
No! Now this must not be. We are rough men who lead a rough life, but we are not so utterly rough as to deprive thee of thy love. Oh, I think I'm safe in saying there is not one here who would rob thee of this inestimable.
Inestimable.
There is not one here who would rob thee of this inestimable treasure.
Not one!
No, I thought there wasn't.
Keep thy love, Frederick. Keep thy love.
You're very good, I'm sure.
Well, it's the top of the tide. We must be off.
Farewell, Frederick.
When your process of extermination begins, let our deaths be as swift and painless as you can possibly make them.
I will. I swear it by the love I have for you. Would that you could render this extermination unnecessary by accompanying me back to civilization.
No, Frederick, it cannot be.
I gotta watch that boat.
It cannot be. No. I don't think much of piracy as a profession, but contrasted with respectability, it is comparatively honest. No, Frederick, I shall live and die a pirate king!
Yeah! Oh, better far to live and die under the brave black flag I fly than play a sanctimonious part with a pirate head and a pirate heart. Away to the cheating world go you, where pirates all are well-to-do. But I'll be true to the song I sing and live and die a pirate king. For I am a pirate king. It is a glorious thing to be a pirate king, for I am a pirate king. It is a glorious thing to be a pirate king.
It is a rough the pirate king, a rough the pirate king.
forth to seek my prey. I help myself in a royal way. I sink a few more ships, it's true, than a well-bred monarch ought to do. But many a king on a first-class throne, if he wants to call his crown his own, must manage somehow to get through more dirty work than ever I do. For I am a pirate king, and it is what you sing to be a pirate king. But I am a pirate king. A glorious thing to be a pirate king.
It is the role for the pirate king, the role for the pirate king.
There are friends of mine that I may flog for taking more than their share of grog. Helpless men may feel my whip as I'm practicing my marksmanship. Although I'm a man with a heart of gold, I've a reputation to uphold. So bound am I to prove my sting. And truly be a pirate king. For I am a pirate king. It has a glorious ring, the name of Pirate King. For I am a pirate king. And it is a glorious thing to be a pirate king.
It is the role of the pirate king, the role of the pirate king.
Very dear to me, but I must be circumspect. You are considerably older than I. A lad of 21 usually looks for a wife of 17.
A wife of 17? You shall find me a wife of 1,000.
No, but I shall find you a wife of 47, and that is quite enough. Ruth, tell me candidly and without reserve, compared with other women, how are you?
I will answer you truthfully, Master. I have a slight cold, but apart from that, I'm very well.
I'm very sorry for your cold, but I was referring rather to your personal appearance compared with other women. Are you beautiful?
I have been told so, dear Master.
Ah, but lately.
Oh. No, years and years ago.
Yes. Well, what do you think of yourself?
Well, now that's a delicate question to answer, but I consider myself a fine woman.
And that is your candid opinion?
Yes. I should be deceiving you if I told you otherwise.
Thank you, Ruth. I believe you, for I'm sure you would not practice on my inexperience. I wish to do the right thing, and if you really are a fine woman, your age shall be no obstacle to our union. Hark. Surely I hear voices. Who has ventured to approach our pirate lair? Can it be Custom House? No, that does not sound like Custom House.
Confusion. It is the voices of young girls. If he sees them, I'm lost.
By all that's marvelous, a bevy of beautiful maidens.
Lost! Lost! Oh, lost!
How lovely. How surpassingly lovely is the plainest of them. What grace. What delicacy. What refinement. And Ruth. Ruth told me she was beautiful. Oh, false one, you have deceived me.
I had deceived
I'm sure I'm not a jot so.
Upon my innocence you play.
I'm not the one to plot so.
Your face is lined, your hair is gray.
Gradually got so.
Faithless woman to deceive me, I who trusted so.
Master, master, do not leave me, hear me ere you go.
Faithless woman.
Master, master.
Faithless woman.
Master, master.
Faithless woman to deceive me, I who trusted so. Faithless woman to deceive me, I who trusted so.
My love without reflecting, oh, do not be rejecting. Take a maiden tender, her affections raw and green, at very highest rating, have been accumulating. Some are 17, some are 17.
Yes, your former master saves you from disaster. What would be uncomfortably firm, it is clear.
My love,
if, as you are stating,
has been accumulating 47 years.
47 years.
47 years.
Faithless woman to deceive me, I trust. Trusted so, faithless woman, to deceive me, I be trusted so. Gentle maidens, I dare not show in this alarming costume. No, no, I must remain in close concealment until I can appear in decent clothing.
Climbing over rocky mountains, skipping rivulets, a boat, a crossing where the presently. Remember, poor Papa is not as young as we are. And we did come over rather difficult country.
Yes. But how thoroughly delightful it is to be so entirely alone. Why, in all probability, we are the first human beings to ever set foot on this enchanting spot.
Except for mermaids. It's the very place for mermaids,
who are only human beings down to the waist.
Ooh.
And who can't be strictly said to set foot anywhere. Tails they may, but feet they cannot.
But whatever shall we do until Papa arrives?
Well, we are quite alone. And the sea is as smooth as glass. Suppose we take off our... Suppose we take off our shoes.
Oh, but Edith, think of propriety. This beach being so injudiciously sandy, will not then our shoes have become likewise? And in the removing of them, will not our gowns be similarly soiled?
Oh, dear. Oh, that's true. Then have we any choice, Isabel, but to take off our gowns as well?
Yes! Yes! Our gowns as well!
Oh, Edith, does that not leave you in great danger?
Great danger?
Yes. Might not the crew of some ship, while passing by at sea, be suddenly attracted by the whiteness and delicacy of our skin? And observe us here, and you without your hat.
Oh!
Would not then your standing in the social register be grievously reduced?
It would.
Well, should we not then, sisters, in deference to familial responsibility, remove our hats as well?
Yes! 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 Our hats as well!
Oh, but Edith, what now? Is this not yet worst of all? For having removed our petticoats and removed our gowns, might we not now freely paddle in the sea, the unaccustomed stimulation of which could in turn blind us to proper caution, thereby endangering our gloves?
Well, then, to eliminate the risk of their permanent ruination and the resulting need for their immediate replacement, which in turn might endanger poor father's financial and personal health. Have we any option at all then, sisters, than of our own free will to remove our gloves as well? Yes! Yes! Yes. Our gloves as well!
Intended not to intrude myself upon your notice in this effective, but alarming costume. But under these peculiar circumstances, it is my bounden duty to tell you that your proceedings will not be unwitnessed.
But who are you, sir? Speak.
I am a pirate.
A pirate! Oh!
Me. This evening I renounce my vile profession, and to that end, O pure and peerless maiden, O blushing buds of ever-blooming beauty, I soar at heart, I sore at heart, implore your kind assistance.
How pitiful his tale,
how rare his beauty,
how pitiful his tale.
Does not feel the moral beauty of making worldly interest subordinate to sense of duty. Who would not give up willingly all matrimonial ambition to rescue such an one as I? His unfortunate position from his position to rescue such an one as I from his unfortunate
he has gone astray, but pray.
gentle sister, say, propriety we know says we ought to stay, while sympathy exclaims, free them from your tether, play at other games, leave them here together. Her case may any day be yours, my dear, for mine. Let her make her hay while the sun doth shine. Let us compromise our hearts and walls of leather. Let us shut our eyes and talk about the weather.
Yes, yes, let's talk about the weather. How beautifully blue the sky.
The glass is rising very high.
Continue on, I hope it may, and yet it may. But yesterday, tomorrow, we may fall again. I hear the country wants a rain that people say. I know that why that we shall have a warm July. Tomorrow, it may fall again. I hear the country wants a rain that people say. I know that why that we shall have a warm July. Tomorrow, it may fall again. I hear the
country wants a rain that people say.
Senses, men who stick at no offences will anon be here. Piracy, that dreadful trade, is play. You get you hench young ladies while the coast is clear.
No, we must not lose our senses. If they stick at no offences, we should not be here.
To get married with impunity and indulge in love and liberty of unbounded domesticity. Quickly be personified, conjugally matched and modified by a doctor of divinity who is located in this vicinity.
Give us our opportunity of escaping with impunity. So amount of love, felicity of unbounded domesticity. Quickly be personified, conjugally matched and modified by a doctor of divinity who is located in this vicinity.
By a doctor of divinity who resides in this vicinity.
Against our will to wed us all. Just bear in mind that we are wards in Chancery. And father is a major general.
We better pause, for danger may befall. Their father is a major general.
Yes, yes, he is a major general.
Yes, yes, I am a major general.
Thank you.
water, nature, general. Life, information, vegetable, animal, and mineral. I know the kings of England and I quote the fights historical. From Marathon to Waterloo in order categorical. I am very well acquainted too with matters mathematical. I understand equations both the simple and quadratical. About binomial theorems, I'm teeming with a lot of news. Lot of news.
Papa?
With many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse.
With many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse. Many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse. Many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse.
I am very good at integral and differential calculus. I know the scientific names of beings and animalculus. In short, in manners, vegetable, animal, and mineral. I am the very model of a modern nature general.
In short, in manners, vegetable, animal, and mineral. He is the very model of a modern nature general.
I know a mythic history, King Arthur's and Sir Caradox. I answer hard acrostics, I have a pretty taste for paradox. I quote in elegiacs all the primes of Heliogapolis. In conics, I can floor peculiarities, parabolas.
Hey!
I can tell undoubted Raphael's from Jared Delson's Ophanies. I know the croaky chorus from the frogs of Aristophanes. And I can hum a fugue of which I've heard the music's dinner for. Dinner for. And whistle all the airs from that infernal nonsense pinafore.
Whistle all the airs from that infernal nonsense pinafore. And whistle all the airs from that infernal nonsense pinafore. And whistle all the airs from that infernal nonsense pinafore.
Then I can write a washing bill in Babylonic cuneiform and give you every detail of Caractacus this uniform. In short, in annals, vegetable, animal, and mineral, I am the very model of a modern nature general.
In short, in annals, vegetable, animal, and mineral, he is the very model of a modern nature general.
In fact, when I know what is meant by mammalon and ravelin, when I can tell its sight a Mauser rifle from a javelin, when such affairs as sorties and surprises I'm more wary at, and when I know precisely what is meant by commissariat, when I have learned what progress has been made in modern gunnery, when I know more of tactics than a novice in a nunnery, in short, when I've a smattering of elemental strategy, strategy, attitude, batigy, natigy, matigy, satigy. You'll say a better major general is never satigy.
You'll say a better major general is never satigy. You'll say a better major general is never satigy. You'll say a better major general is never satigy.
My military knowledge, though I'm plucky and adventury, has only been brought down to the beginning of the century. But still in manners, vegetable, animal, and mineral, I am the very model of a modern nature general.
But still in manners, vegetable, animal, and mineral, he is the very model of a modern nature
general. In all areas, artistic or didactical, from things utilitarian to totally impractical. I know the dates of great events, both wonderful and sinister. I even know how short a time John Turner was Prime Minister. I memorized all principles, logistic and mechanical. In many ways, I am Encyclopedia Britannical. I've knowledge as gratuitous as how an ancient lute is played. Lute is played? So I'm always in demand whenever trivial pursuit is played.
He's always in demand whenever trivial pursuit is played. He's always in demand whenever trivial pursuit is played. He's always in demand whenever trivial pursuit is played.
But one thing I don't understand is anything Shakespearean, except it's played in theatres that I get very weary in. But in most manners, vegetable, animal, and mineral, I am the very model of a modern nature general.
In most manners, vegetable, animal, and mineral, he is the very model of a modern nature general.
Introduced myself, I should like to have some idea of what's going on.
Oh, Papa, we were playing.
Permit me! I shall explain in two words. We propose to marry your daughter!
Yeah. Me?
You
mustn't do that. May I ask, this is a very picturesque uniform, but I'm not familiar with it. What are you?
We are all single gentlemen.
Yes, I gather that. Anything else?
No, nothing else.
Don't believe them, Papa! They are pirates! The famous pirates of Penzance!
The
pirates of Penzance. I've often heard of them.
Oh, all except this gentleman.
I was a pirate once, but today I am out of my indentures.
And he promises to lead a blameless life evermore.
But wait a bit, wait a bit. I object to pirates as sons-in-law.
We object to major generals as fathers-in-law.
But we waive that point. We do not press it. We look over it.
An idea. Do you mean to say that you would deliberately rob me of these my daughters, the sole remaining props of my old age, and leave me to go through the remainder of my life unfriended, unprotected, and alone?
Well, yes, that's the idea.
Tell me, have you ever known what it is to be an orphan?
Here we go again!
I ask you, have you ever known what it is to be an orphan?
Orphan.
Orphan, have you ever known what it is to be one?
And I say orphan.
Orphan!
I don't think we quite understand one another. I ask you if you've ever known what it is to be an orphan, and you say orphan. Now, as I understand it, you are merely repeating the word orphan to show that you understand me.
I didn't repeat the word orphan.
Pardon me, indeed you did.
I only repeated it once.
True, but you repeated it.
Yes, but not orphan.
Stop, stop. I think I know where we're getting confused. Oh. Now, when you say orphan, mm-hmm. Do you mean orphan, a person who has lost his parents, mm-hmm. or orphan frequently?
Oh! I beg your pardon, I see what you mean, frequently.
Oh, so you said orphan frequently.
No, only once.
Exactly. You said orphan frequently, only once. Oh, men of dark and dismal fate, forgo your cruel employ. Have pity on my lonely state. I am an orphan boy.
An orphan boy.
An orphan boy.
How sad, an orphan boy.
These children whom you see are all that I can call my own.
Poor fellow.
Take them away from me and I shall be indeed alone.
Poor fellow.
If pity you can feel, leave me my soul, remaining joy. See, at your feet they kneel, your heart you cannot steal, against the sad, sad tale of the lonely orphan. Boy.
Poor fellow, see at our feet they kneel, our hearts we cannot steal, against the sad, sad tale of the lonely orphan boy.
Orphan boy, the orphan boy, see at our feet they kneel, our hearts we cannot steal, against the tale of the lonely orphan boy.
Poor fellow.
I'm telling a terrible story, but it doesn't diminish my glory, for they would have taken my daughters over the billowy waters if I hadn't in elegant diction indulged in an innocent fiction, which is not in the same category as telling a regular terrible story.
If he's telling a terrible story, she'll marry a delicious story. It's one of the coolest horses ever known in these waters.
It is easy in accusation to call it an innocent fiction, but it comes to the same category as telling a regular terrible story. It is easy in accusation to call it an innocent fiction, but it comes to the same category as telling a regular story.
Although a dark career sometimes involves the crime of stealing, we'd rather think that we're not altogether void of feeling. Although we live by strife, we're always sorry to begin it. For what we ask is life without a touch of poetry in it.
At liberty, our pirate rules protect you, and honorary members of our band, we do elect you.
For he is an orphan boy.
He is a roughly orphan boy.
And it sometimes is a useful thing to be an orphan boy.
It is a roughly orphan boy. A roughly orphan boy.
Of a domesticity, 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 of a domesticity
In a moment, Act Two of Gilbert and Sullivan's The Pirates of Penzance, recorded live from the Stratford Festival of Canada.
Excellence of your wisdom, reconcile it with your conscience to say something that will relieve my father's sorrow.
I will try, dear Mabel. But why does he sit night after night in this drafty old ruin?
Why do I sit here? Why do I sit here? I'll tell you why I sit here. To escape the clutches of these pirates, I described myself as an orphan. And heaven knows I'm no orphan. So I came here to humble myself at the tombs of my ancestors and to implore their pardon for having brought dishonor on the family scutcheon.
But you forget, sir, you only bought the property a year ago. Why, the stucco on your baronial castle is scarcely dry.
Frederick, in this chapel there are ancestors. You cannot deny that. Look, look. You see, with the estate, I bought the chapel and its contents. Now, I don't know whose ancestors they were, but I know whose they are now. And I shudder to think that their descendant by purchase, if I may so describe myself, has brought disgrace upon what I have no doubt was an unstained scutcheon.
Oh, be comforted, sir. Had you not acted as you did, why, these reckless men would most assuredly have called in the nearest clergyman and married your large family on the spot.
Oh,
yes.
I assure you that such is the anguish and remorse I feel for the abominable falsehood by which I escaped to these easily deluded pirates, that I would go to their simple-minded chief this very night and confess all. Did I not fear that the consequences would be most disastrous for myself and my daughters? At what time does your expedition march against these scoundrels?
At 11.
At 11.
But before midnight, I will have atoned for my involuntary association with these pirates by sweeping them from the face of the earth. And then, dear Mabel, you will be mine.
Are your devoted followers at hand?
They are. They only wait my orders.
Then, Frederick, let your escort, lion-hearted, be summoned to receive a general's blessing ere they depart upon their dread adventure.
Dear sir, they come.
There's his deal.
Ta-ra-ta-ra-ta-ra-ta-ra.
We uncomfortable feel.
Ta-ra-ta-ra.
And we find the wisest thing.
Ta-ra-ta-ra-ta-ra-ta-ra.
Is to slap our chests and sing.
Ta-ra-ta-ra.
Or when threatened with a newt.
Ta-ra-ta-ra-ta-ra-ta-ra.
And your heart is in your boot.
Ta-ra-ta-ra.
There is nothing brings it out like the trumpet's martial sound. Like the trumpet's martial sound.
Ta-ra-ta-ra-ta-ra-ta-ra.
These attentions are well meant.
Ta-ra-ta-ra.
Such expressions don't appear.
Ta-ra-ta-ra, ta-ra-ta-ra.
Calculated men to cheer.
Ta-ra-ta-ra.
Who are going to meet their fate in a highly nervous state?
Ta-ra-ta-ra, ta-ra-ta-ra, ta-ra-ta-ra.
Still to us it's evident your attentions are well meant.
Ta-ra-ta-ra, ta-ra-ta-ra, ta-ra-ta-ra.
Observe to greater stress on the risks that on us press, and of reference a lack to our chance of coming back. Still, perhaps it would be wise not to carp or criticize, for it's very evident these attentions are well meant.
Yes, it's very evident these attentions are well meant. Evident, yes, well meant. Evident, ah, yes, well meant.
its lair. Oh, joy unbounded, oh, sweet relief, oh, rapture unexampled. At last I may atone in some slight measure for the repeated acts of theft and pillage, of which, at a sense of duty's stern dictation, I'm circumstances' victim, have been guilty.
Young Frederick,
who calls
me commander,
and I, your little Ruth.
Ruth, oh, mad intruders, how dare ye face me? Know ye not, oh rash ones, that I have doomed you to extermination?
Have mercy on us.
Hear us ere you slaughter. I do not think I ought to listen to you, yet mercy should alloy my stern resentment. And so I will be merciful.
Say on.
When you had let our pirate fall, we tried to raise our spirits faint according to our custom bold with quips and quibbles quaint. But all in vain, the quips we heard, we lay and sobbed upon the rocks until to somebody occurred a startling paradox.
A paradox.
A paradox.
A most ingenious paradox.
We quips and quibbles heard in flocks, but none to beat this paradox.
A paradox, a most ingenious paradox. This paradox.
We knew your taste for curious quips, for cranks and contradictions queer, and so with laughter on our lips, we wished you there to hear. We said if we could tell it him, how Frederick would the joke enjoy, and so we risked both life and limb to tell it to our boy.
That paradox!
That paradox!
That most ingenious paradox. We've quips and quibbles heard in flocks, but none to beat this paradox.
A paradox, a most ingenious paradox. This paradox!
For some ridiculous reason to which, however, I've no desire to be disloyal, some person in authority, I don't know who, very likely the Astronomer Royal, has decided that although for such a beastly month as February, 28 days as a rule are plenty, 1 year in every four, his days shall be reckoned as 29. Through some singular coincidence, I shouldn't be surprised if it were owing to the agency of an ill-natured fairy. You are the victim of this clumsy arrangement, having been born in leap year on the 29th of February. And so by a simple arithmetical process, you will easily discover that though you've lived 21 years, yet if we go by birthdays, you are only 5. And a little bit over.
Dear me, let's see. Yes, with yours my figures do agree. How great the ways of paradox that common sense she gaily mocks, though counting in the usual way is 21 I've been alive, yet reckoning by my natal day.
Wait.
Yet reckoning by my natal day. I am a little boy of 5.
He's a little boy of 5.
A paradox, a most ingenious paradox. This paradox. A curious paradox. A
Upon my word, this is most curious, most absurdly whimsical 5 1/4. No one would think it to look at me.
Oh, you can now, I'll be bound that you spared us. You'd never have forgiven yourself when you discovered you'd killed 2 of your comrades.
My comrades?
I'm afraid you don't appreciate the delicacy of your position. You were apprenticed to us.
Yes, until my 21st year.
No, until your 21st birthday. And going by birthdays, you are as yet only 5 1/4.
You don't mean to say you're going to hold me to that?
No! We merely remind you of the fact and leave the rest to your sense of duty.
Your sense of duty?
Don't keep putting it on that footing. Be merciful to me, as I was merciful to you just now. I implore you not to insist upon the letter of your bond, just as the cup of happiness is at my lip.
Oh, we insist on nothing. We content ourselves with pointing out to you your duty.
Your duty. Well, you have appealed to my sense of duty, and my duty is only too clear.
I abhor your infamous calling. I shudder at the thought that I have ever been mixed up with it, but duty is before all, and at any price I must do my duty.
Oh, bravely spoken! Come, Frederick, you're one of us once more.
Lead on, I follow. Oh, horror!
What is the matter?
What I should tell you. No, no, I cannot do it. And yet, as a pirate once again...
Speak out! I charge you by that sense of conscientiousness. Conscientiousness.
Conscientiousness.
I charge you by that sense of conscientiousness to which we have never yet appealed in vain.
General Stanley, the father of my Mabel.
Yes.
He escaped from you on the plea that he was an orphan.
He did.
It breaks my heart to betray the honored father of the girl I adore, but as your apprentice, it is my duty to tell you that General Stanley is no orphan.
What?
More than that, he never was one.
Am I to understand that to save his contemptible life, General Stanley dared to practice on our credulous simplicity? Oh, our revenge shall be swift and terrible. We'll go and collect our band and attack this castle tonight.
Oh, but stay!
Not a word! He is doomed. Away, away, my heart's on fire. I burn this base deception to repay. This very night, my vengeance dire shall love itself in gore. Away, away!
Away, away, ere I expire, I find my duty hard to do today. My heart is filled with anguish dire. It strikes me to the core. Away, away!
Us of our brides, then vengeance how the pirate so decides. Our nature stern he softened with his lies, and in return tonight the traitor dies.
Yes, yes, tonight the traitor dies.
Yes, yes, tonight the traitor dies.
Tonight he dies.
His early tomorrow,
his girls likewise.
His sorrow,
the one soft spot.
In the nature they cherish,
and all blood.
To abuse it shall perish.
Tonight he dies, his early tomorrow. His girls likewise, never once in his sorrow. The one soft spot in the nature they cherish, and all blood. To abuse it shall perish. Away, away, away. Tonight the traitor dies. Away, away, tonight, tonight, tonight.
Until I reach my 1 1/20th birthday.
But you are 21.
just discovered that I was born in leap year, and that birthday will not be reached by me till 1940.
Oh, horrible catastrophe, appalling.
And so my soul appalls, but when stern duty calls, I must obey.
Stay, Frederick, stay.
Nay, but nay.
Have no clay.
By duty's name, the sun, my soul appalls, and when stern duty calls,
stay, Frederick, stay.
I must obey. Must I leave thee here in endless night to dream, where joy is dark and drear, and sorrow all supreme, where In 1940, I of age shall be. I'll then return and claim you, I declare it.
It seems so long.
Swear that till then you will be true to me.
Yes, I'll be strong. By all the Stanleys dead and gone, I swear. Sacrifice to his sense of duty has endeared him to me tenfold. But if it was his duty to constitute himself my foe, it is likewise my duty to regard him in that light. He has done his duty, I will do mine. Go ye and do yours.
Righto.
This is perplexing.
We cannot understand it at all.
Still, as he is actuated by a sense of duty,
that makes a difference, of course. At the same time, we repeat, we cannot understand it at all.
No matter. Our course is clear. We must do our best to capture these pirates.
Alone.
It is most distressing to us to be the agents whereby our erring fellow creatures are deprived of that liberty which is so dear to us all. But we should have thought of that before we joined the force.
We should.
It is too late now.
It is.
Oh, When a felon's not engaged in his employment, or maturing his felonious little plans, his capacity for innocent enjoyment, is just as great as any honest man's. Our feelings we with difficulty smother, when constabulary duties to be done, or take one consideration with another. Policeman's lot is not a happy one. Ah, when constabulary duties to be done, a policeman's lot is not a happy one, happy one. When the enterprising burglar's not a burgling, when the cutthroat isn't occupied in crime, he loves to hear the little brook a-gurgling, and listen to the merry village chime, when the coster's finished jumping on his mother, he loves to lie a-basking in the sun, or take one consideration with another, policeman's lot is not a nappy one. Oh, when constabulary duties to be done, a policeman's lot is not a nappy one, nappy one. When constabulary duties to be done, a policeman's lot is not a the pirates are approaching.
We are not coming for plate or gold. The story General Stanley stole. We seek a penalty 50-fold for General Stanley's story.
We seek a penalty 50-fold. We seek a penalty 50-fold. We seek a penalty 50-fold for General Stanley's story.
They come in force with stealthy stride. Our obvious course is now to hide.
With a cat like tread upon a prey we steal, the silence dread, a cautious way we feel. No sound at all, we never speak a word. A 5-foot pole would be distinct. We heard a ta-la, ta-la-ta-la. So stealthily the pirate creeps while all the household comes to meet. Come then to plow the seas, just to navigation, take another station.
Center bit, your life preserver. You may want.
giant matches, your dark lantern sees. Take your flood and your skeletonic key.
By the anguish, dread of falsehood unatoned, I lay upon my sleepless bed and tossed and turned and groaned. The man who finds his conscience eek, no peace at all enjoys. And as I lay in bed awake, I thought I heard a noise.
He thought he heard a noise. Ha ha!
No, all is still. In tale on hill, my mind is set at ease. So still the scene, it must have been the sighing of the priest. Sighing softly to the river comes the loving breeze, setting nature all a quiver, rustling through the trees.
Through the trees.
And the brook in rippling measure laughs for very love, while the poplars in their pleasure wave their arms above.
Yes, the trees for every love.
But a rover when he wings away, brook and poplar mourn a lover sighing,
well-a-day.
And the doing and undoing that the rogue will tell, when the breeze is out a-wooing, who can woo so well?
Surely tales are old.
Sound the lot of poplar trees, courted by joy or rapture, summon your men and effect their capture.
Beautiful Mabel, I would if I could, but I am not able.
He's telling the truth, he is not able.
With base deceit, you worked upon our feelings. Revenge is sweet and flavors all our dealings. With courage rare and resolution manly, for death prepare unhappy General Stanley.
Is he to die a shriven on a needle?
Oh, spare him!
Will no one in his cause or weapon wield?
Oh, spare him!
Yes, we are here, though hither to conceal.
Advantage you've contrived, but your proud triumph will not be long lived.
Don't say you're orphans, for we know that game.
On your allegiance we've a stronger claim. We charge you, Yale.
Ha, ha.
We charge you, Yale.
Ha.
And in Queen Victoria's
charge you, yield in Queen Victoria's
name. We yield at once with humble knee, because with all our faults we love.
Yes, yes, with all their faults, they love their queen. Yes, yes, with all our faults, they love our queen.
Away with them and place them at the bar.
One moment. Let me tell you who they are. They are no members of the common throng. They are all noblemen who have gone wrong.
They are all noblemen who have gone wrong.
No Englishman unmoved this statement hears. Because with all our faults, we love our House of Peers. I pray you pardon me, ex-pirate king. Peers will be peers, and youth must have its fling. Resume your rank and legislative duties, and take my daughters, all of whom are beauties.